All right, so this is, I don't even know how to start this because we've never had a husband and wife duo on the show before, yet we've never had a husband and wife duo with one of them being the daughter of the artist that we're going after. We've had the artist. We had Billy Gibbons from ZZ Top break down whatever that record was. Hit Me. Eliminator. Thank you. But also, I never had a dude on the show that I can honest to God say I changed the direction of me loving music, and it's when you rapped, Scott, with Chuck D in Bring the Noise, dude.
Right on.
I don't think you get, like, how that changed my life at summer camp. Like, I was on the Jungle Gym. I'm wearing an Anthrax shirt now. I was going to wear my Mr. Bungle shirt because I saw y'all last concert before COVID.
Oh, right on. In Brooklyn?
No. In Los Angeles.
Oh,
and,
okay.
And can I be honest with you? I had no idea you guys were going to be playing that record the whole time. I was like, when are they going to play Pink Cadillac? And you didn't. So we are here today to thank you, both you guys. I mean, it taking time out of your lives. I appreciate it. But we're here to talk about a record. And I mean this sincerely with what I'm about to say. So I've been doing this podcast for about 3 years. No record I have loved more. For the first time, I hate to say, this is the first time I've ever listened to this record from start to finish. And in the 2 or 3 weeks that I've been digging on it, I probably listened to it nearly 100 times because I think it's a perfect album. So without further ado, Scott and Pearl, thank you both so much for coming on the podcast today. I appreciate it.
Right on.
Thanks,
man.
Thanks for having us.
Yeah.
How is your COVID? How are you guys? Are there any projects you guys want to promote? Please feel free to take this moment to do that.
We're good.
Yeah, we're good. Healthy. Yeah.
Good.
Successfully quarantined, successfully vaccinated.
Homeschooled, now back in person.
Out playing shows again. Well, yeah, on weekends, festivals, and everyone's remained healthy. We got one Anthrax show left this year at Welcome to Rockville down in Daytona on November 14th.
Nice.
But that's sold out, so
it's on you if you didn't get tickets, dude. Yeah, but, sold out. It's pretty badass.
I mean, you know, Pearl's got a show coming up in Silver Lake in December, December 23rd.
And Motor Sister. We have a new Motor Sister album
there'll
coming.
Be a new Motor Sister record next year at some point, and maybe a new Anthrax album late next year if, you know, we can really think we're writing and, you know, fingers crossed we'll get in the studio early next year or something like that.
Dude, please.
Yeah.
Please. We need it. We want it. It's time. It's time. Dude, even Adam's wearing, he's wearing the Big Four shirt, dude.
Oh, yeah.
Right. Yankee Stadium show.
All right. So usually this is how I start it. Usually I say, take me back to the first moment you heard of Meatloaf. I mean, what was your birth like? No, what? No, I mean, like, so let's do you first, Scott. Like, tell me, cause you're dude, you in a sense with Anthrax kind of started the thrash metal movement. Like, how does someone that digs that shit get into Bat Out of Hell? Because from my understanding, I didn't realize how big this record was until I've looked at all the numbers. But for you, take me there. Take me to that first moment you heard this.
Oh, Meatloaf comes way before thrash metal or Anthrax or anything because the record came out in what, 77?
70, yeah, Adam, 77?
Yeah. So I was already way into music. Most, you know, rock and hard rock. I don't even think heavy metal was a term being used yet at that point in time. Like in 1977, I was Kiss was my favorite band. I was way into Cheap Trick and the Ramones and Ted Nugent and AC/DC, and I was definitely like a hard rock kid. And I'm gonna say that I got into that Bat Out of Hell record initially through my dad, because my dad listened to pretty good music, and he had it on in the car. One day he had like the 8-track and had it on in the car, and I remember hearing like Bat Out of Hell and Paradise by the Dashboard Light, and just being blown away, just completely blown away by the whole thing. And and then of course, you know, their album at some point when the album starts to break and Paradise and like Two Out of Three Ain't Bad basically become, I mean, they're, it's just everywhere on every radio station. And I always just thought it, for me, not really knowing so much how things work, it seemed like such a New York thing because everybody was into it. I mean, Meatloaf blew up so quickly in New York. Like all my friends, their parents, like, and I guess that's the point I was going to make in the beginning was, this was the first time since I was a little kid, you know, when you don't really listen to your own music, you're listening to whatever's on in the house. I got into Kiss. My parents didn't like Kiss. Yeah. From that point, you know, I was into my shit. They were into their shit.
Yeah.
But my dad loved Meatloaf and I loved Meatloaf. And it was kind of cool that we got into something again now, like at the same time. And I love that album. I'm going to say right now, too, at the top of this thing, this is number 343 on the list.
Yeah. But
I have a huge problem with that. That dude. Means, I mean, I know there's a million problems with this list, which we're not going to get into.
Millions, dude. But, millions. Right.
But the idea that whoever voted on this thinks that there's 342 better records than this. Now, I'm sure out of those 342 albums that are in front of this on the list, yes, maybe some of them are better. And I'm sure even maybe Meatloaf might agree with some of them. but I have a huge problem that this isn't like top 30.
Yeah.
You know, even. I think I could probably argue that this should be top 30. So, it's an amazing record. Anyway, that's how I discovered it, through my dad. And then I had the record, I bought the vinyl, and we went to see him play at the Calderon Concert Hall on Long Island. It was like May of 1978. And we saw him live on that tour as well. And it was totally mind blowing.
I mean, this list, first of all, is complete and utter BS. This is we just did like literally a couple hours before I recorded this, we just did Lou Reed Berlin, which is one of the most depressing records in the history of records. It's literally about the story of like a meth addict and a prostitute, and it's like that's ahead of like Let It Be by the Beatles, and you're like, what?
Right.
So this list is literally just a way for me to listen to albums. We respect the list, but we can also disagree with it because there's a lot of shit that got left off. And then wait till I get to the fact at the end where we check to see if this is on the 2020 list, because this is the 2012 list.
Oh, okay. So right.
Hopefully it's still on there, but the list is crap.
Well, maybe 2020 rectified the mistake and it put it way higher.
Adam, you wrote this. You wrote my stuff.
Do you want me to spoil it for you right now? Or
No.
So this is the last time.
We want to be in a good mood. We want to be in a good mood. They seem happy right now. I don't even know, because I'm judging by that. So Pearl, I mean, I don't even know how to get started with this. I mean, this album probably has been just in your ethos since, you know, early memories. I mean, tell me, because I mean, you've like sang and toured with your dad, you know, in the 90s. Like, what is that like, being the child of somebody that created, I mean this record is just, it's not that, I'm not going to say masterpiece, but like you said, it was everywhere. It was everywhere in New York, from what Scott's saying. So like tell me your experiences, thoughts, whatever. I don't even know where to go, but just you lead me.
Wow. Well, I mean, the first thing I'm thinking of is that it's true. I've been hearing this album my entire life. And the one thing that stands out to me is that it's still, every time I hear it, it still moves me.
Yeah.
I'm not used to it. You know what I mean? In the sense of like, ugh, I don't need to hear that song again or that song again. And you know, I did sing with my dad and his touring band for 9 years on the Bat 2 tour, and every single night, this is 9 years of this, every single night I can honestly say that when the first note of the song Bat Out of Hell started, it was just an incredible adrenaline rush. It's like, let's go every single time.
Yeah.
That the song is, it's incredible. It's incredibly written. the love songs on that album are beyond. Do you know For Crying Out Loud?
Yeah.
Listen to that one.
I've listened to this record over almost 100 times. Dude, this is for me, this is like the first time I've ever listened to this record. I hate to say that. You know, I've known Meatloaf, you know, your dad from, you know, I know from Rocky Horror Picture Show, and he's the man in that. And that was like my first, oh, who's that guy? And everybody, Bad Outta Hell. And then when, you know, I Can Do Anything for Love came out, I was like, yeah, this song rules. But I was like, you know, it's not really my style, but it's still this song that's just, it was so popular when it came out. But Bad Outta Hell, dude, and I'm so embarrassed to say this, but that's why I'm doing this podcast. I was like, I never listened to it. I just knew about it. And then a few weeks ago, I put it on because I wanted to get ahead of what's on the list. And I probably listened to, what's the second track on the record, Adam? The
Words Right Out of My Mouth.
Oh, Mike, I listened to that 40 times. I'm one of those guys that listened to a song like 100 times in a row. Just like you can't get over it. And yeah. I mean, it's beautiful. Everything that you just said, 100%. The love songs hit deep. And it's like it you dream of a love that you might one day get to experience. I don't think I've ever heard a better album opener so far on this podcast or a better album closer. Paradise is incredible. The final song on the record, where is it? That's
Crying Out Loud. Yeah.
I mean, yeah, dude, it's one of the most beautiful songs. You can hear the pain, you know, it's you can so hear the emotions. Yeah. It's so heartbreaking. I mean, so what is that like being on stage and seeing the audience just, I mean, they must have just gone completely bananas when he plays anything off of this record.
Yeah, my dad has some pretty hardcore fans, as do a lot of artists. But yeah, the experience of growing up watching my dad on stage, and then by the time I was 19, I joined him on stage. I had to audition, by the way.
Nice.
Which I really appreciate, and I yeah, I just love that story. But then being on stage with him and being part of the music that's being made and watching him perform those songs every night, it was mind blowing. You know, songs like Heaven Can Wait.
Yeah.
When he would just break it down and it was him and just the piano player, you know, it brings tears to your eyes every night. You know, I never get tired of it. You never take it for granted. There's just some kind of magic about this album that, I mean, it really speaks to, we were talking about it in the car today. It really speaks to the genius of Jim Steinman, who wrote the songs, who, in our opinion, doesn't get enough credit for being on that tippy top list of all time great songwriters. I mean, he does get credit for that, but not in the same way he should. You know,
I think these songs are pure Americana. They should be part of the Great American Songbook.
Yeah,
I mean, to me, Steinman, what he created on this record, it's right there with, you know, early Bruce Springsteen, the Born to Run record, and in that same way. And you know, he doesn't get that same level of recognition that a Springsteen gets. But I mean, come on, when you listen to this album, Bad Outta Hell, 2 out of 3, Paradise by the Dashboard Light. I mean, I don't know how, you know, these songs, they go down as some of the greatest songs ever written. And he definitely does not get the credit he deserves.
Well, it was truly original. He wrote in the truly original way that was very specific to him, just like Bruce Springsteen writes in this way that's specific to him. That's where the magic is, I think.
Where do you guys think about that comparison? Because as I've been reading about this, they keep saying that this is, you know, this is a Born to Run. Like, how do you guys feel about that comparison?
Well, it's a great album. So, you know, I can see it because there are a lot of similarities in that, you know, use that word again, Americana, you know, very much a lot of these, you know, songs about, you know, loves lost and found and cars, girls, a lot of similarities, and just the massive kind of grandiose, like you take a song like Jungle Land from Springsteen.
Yeah.
You know, to me that and Bat Out of Hell, similar type of, you know, similar type of thing. Just these epic, almost operatic, you know, types of arrangements. And so I could see the comparisons for sure. I just think for me, Steinman has this pop sensibility, you know, and his arrangements of vocal harmonies and everything else, which I'm sure your dad had a lot to do with as well, as far as all the vocal harmonies. Yeah, you know, it's, again, it's, I would almost compare, you know, some of that stuff to Queen, and you know, Queen wasn't even that big of a band yet here,
yeah. Anyway,
you know, when this stuff was being written, because the record came out in 77, but you got to remember they were writing it over a period of years leading up to that. So, you know, to touch on what Pearl said, it's a complete original. It's just so different and original and incredibly epic.
So then why are we, because we were talking about the list, you know, why is this at 343 and Born to Run is in the, I think in the top 15, right. When I feel like both of these records, I mean, are, you go track for track and you can sing along. They're just as good. I mean, is there something like, what is that thing that Meatloaf and Bruce Springsteen have, yet like Bruce is, you know, he's the boss, but Meatloaf is this guy, he's a genius. Him and Jim created something that is damn near perfect. Like, why, thoughts? I don't know. What do you think, Pearl?
I think it's in the way that the press treated each of them separately. You know, Meatloaf's name is Meatloaf, and he's not a skinny little guy. Bruce Springsteen's not a skinny little guy, but you know, Meatloaf doesn't look like Bruce Springsteen.
Sure.
And I think that, you know, it was hard for a lot of people to get past that.
No, completely.
I think.
Which is a shame.
Certainly in the 70s, as there were critics, there were writers that loved the Bat Out of Hell record. But I think in the overall zeitgeist, let's say at the time, it was much more an album of the people than the press. And he wasn't taken seriously as a songwriter or as a singer. It was like a one-trick pony. It's a shtick. Oh, the big guy in the tuxedo, you know. And it was so much more than that, which he obviously proved by having a career that still goes on. So, but yeah, I just think at the time Springsteen was looked at. He was a critic's darling. It's, you know, he, with all the comparisons to, let's say, Dylan or.
Yeah.
Whoever else, even the older songwriters, I'm not thinking of, like, guys from the 30s and 40s he would get compared to. And I can't think of the guy's name. He wrote lots of protest songs. And Jesus.
Country Joe McDonald. I don't know why that popped in my head.
Carlo Guthrie.
And, okay. Yeah.
Yeah.
Way better.
Woody Guthrie. Right. Like Woody Guthrie. You know, Springsteen's getting these kind of comparisons and you know, taken very, very seriously by the critics. And it was kind of the opposite, I think, for Meatloaf. Certainly by Rolling Stone magazine, who definitely never gave him any love ever. You know, still to this day, not even in the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, which is a fucking joke. Just not taken seriously by the so-called people that matter, you know, at the time. And that's why I say it was definitely, he was a man of the people, not the press.
Well, obviously, I mean, if this sold 50 million copies, I'm pretty sure, Adam, you have a fact that's up here that's saying this just like left the top. Let me see what's up here. Where did you put that? Yeah, this is selling over 50 million copies, certified platinum 14 times, spent 522 weeks on the UK album charts. That's sixth most in the history of that chart. The response in the United States was slow, but it got its break from executive from CBS Canada, recommended it to Warren Cosford, a program director in Toronto, fell in love with it, put it in heavy rotation, and American stations started to follow suit and went on to sell 14 million copies since. I mean, this is like, I mean, you wish, artists dream of being able to make one record or, you know, or have any kind of career, just something that touches that many people. And everything that you just said, like, he's, you know, his name's Meatloaf, he's slightly robust size, you know, that it's still, it's like, you know, he made a record that has touched so many people. I know you're saying the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame and Rolling Stone, but both of them can go fuck themselves. I mean, Devo isn't in the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame.
I mean,
there's so many great artists, and so I mean, there's so many people that are in the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame that we're not even talking about their records. So you know what? They can.
I know. I mean, it's all
it's all BS, dude.
It's all BS.
I mean, dude. Exactly. Also, you're a part of Anthrax, where I mean, it's like. You know, you guys are some of the like the originators of thrash rock. I mean, let me ask you guys a question. Like, how have you dealt with critics being in the spotlight, you know, in your lives?
We don't do anything but write for ourselves. I think that's what almost any artist, that's what they should be doing. If you're writing to please your audience, then I don't even understand that. I don't even know how to talk about that.
Yeah,
we've only ever just written for ourselves, and if people connect with it, they do. And you know, lucky for us, people all around the world connected with what we were doing and what we still do. So, but we've never worried about what anyone had to say about it.
Is there a review though that you've ever like the worst review you've ever gotten, and you guys are just like, dude, this is like flames to like just you know just I'm rock sure even
there,
harder.
There must have been some. Early on, I'm sure. I mean, our last two albums, honestly, or even our last three albums, were so well reviewed that across the board, from like mainstream media to the most kind of underground press. It was almost like can we at least have one bad one? Like, but I'm not complaining about that.
Yeah, right.
But I mean, I'm sure in the early days there must have been because not. Not everybody liked this new sound that, you know, we were playing back then in the early 80s. So, but I don't specifically remember anything, no.
No. Pearl, any shit reviews that you can recollect?
I don't give a shit.
Yeah.
Nice. You know, nice.
My dad always used to say, those who cannot do review. but yeah, there's really, I was taught from a young age, there's really no point in seeking out or looking for reading bad reviews or, you know, mean things that people say about you because it's all subjective anyway. So
yeah, completely.
That guy says or what that chick, if she didn't like it, that's fine. You don't have to like it.
I think the best thing for an artist to ever get is almost no, especially as a comic. It's like when I've had bookers or networks be like, no, it's just made me work harder, dig deeper, you know, pull from more of my personal experience and be more like of myself on stage. And then it's like they start calling you because it's like, oh, it's like you get all those no's. Eventually, you know, you're going to become undeniable where it's just like, oh, no, we have to. Because this guy is so good. So any of the bookers, and they know who they are, you're out there. Thank you. Let me ask you, because you mentioned your dad a moment ago. What was it like growing up with Meatloaf as your dad?
This is a question I get a lot.
I'm sorry. Adam wrote it.
It's Adam's fault.
Adam.
No, damn it.
But no, I get it. I always answer it. Honestly, which is, it was normal to me. It's normal to me, you know, like, well, what's it like having a policeman as a dad? Or what's it like having a surgeon for a dad? Or, you know, my dad is, he's somebody who worked really hard at his job. And he had to sometimes be away a lot, but also we got to travel around the world with him. A lot too, you know, and when he wasn't on tour, when he was between album cycles, he was coaching my softball team. You know, he plays fantasy football when he's home. You know, he's a guy, he's a regular kind of guy who likes regular things and meat and potatoes and, you know, watching football. He loves football.
Well, I mean, well, one, is he good at fantasy football? Because my team's in the shit right now.
He played on a team. You did that team thing with him a couple times, you and Jerry Cantrell. Yeah. And
I've been playing in the Alice in Chains fantasy league for like 10 years. And one year, Jerry said, ask your father-in-law if he wants to play. I know he plays because Meat sometimes will play in like, he'll play in 20 leagues. Oh, and I'm like, sure, I'll ask him. So I wrote him, I said, hey, the guys who run the league are asking if you want to, you know, join for this season. He said, you don't want me in your league.
Yeah, he was like, you sure?
Yeah, and I said, why not?
Oh,
said,
shit.
Because I'm going to win. I will crush all of you. And I was like,
well, he's brutally still competitive, yeah, by the way, if you haven't caught on.
And we were like, well, still, yeah, we want you. You know, they love to have you. We want you this year. It's all done for charity. And he's like, I'm just letting you know right now, I'm going to win. And I'm like, okay, cool. And he did. He won. He
called it. Dude, that's like, what's that? So then let me ask you, Scott, because, you know, you meet Pearl, you know, obviously, you know who her dad is. What is that like meeting this guy that you listen to, your dad turned you on to? Because I know as a musician and you've played with some of the greats, you've met some of your heroes in a sense. So you're meeting Meatloaf. Like, what is your first, like, because this album is so theatrical. My next question was basically like, you know, like, how important is theatrics in your music? But is he anything like this record?
You mean just like, no, he's not like, yeah, just, he's not running around the house like doing big massive gestures and yeah, falling down and needing oxygen. No, he's not like that. I will say he is a, you know, he can be a very intense guy because he, you know, it's just, that's part of his makeup. You know, it certainly is part of who he is as a person. I'll say I was definitely nervous. I don't know that I would have been so nervous to meet him in a non I'm taking your daughter out for a date situation.
Yeah.
Like if I just happened to meet him somewhere, it would have been great. But I would have nothing to be nervous about, but I'm showing up, you know, I'm picking up Pearl. And because you were actually, you were kind of living part time at their house at the time, right? Mm-hmm. So I'm like going over there to pick her up and knew he was going to be there. And yeah, I was definitely nervous. Like this, you know, bald, tattooed metal dude is walking in to take your daughter out. I know how I would feel. I was definitely nervous. And he didn't. He didn't go out of his way to make me not nervous initially, which I totally get because even though, you know, Pearl was 25 at the time. So it's not like she's an 18-year-old and
we're sure.
Or like high school kids, but still, you know, it's still his daughter and it's still kind of like, you know, where are you going? Where, you know, what's your plan? Blah, blah, blah. You know, yeah, it was all horrible. I was like super nervous and it was giving me a stomach ache and I was sweating and I'm just wanting to like be cool and impress this lady that I have a huge crush on.
Yeah.
Meanwhile, her dad is Meatloaf and I'm like a sweaty puddle, you know, trying to be cool. It was that first meeting was very difficult. And,
you told me you kept having flashbacks to that like 1978 concert that you went to.
Yeah.
Like sweaty guy in a tuxedo.
Yeah. And I understand the hierarchy, you know, I'm walking into this guy's house to take his daughter out to dinner and he's certainly the bigger rock star. There's no question, you know, the hierarchy level there. So I did everything I could to, you know, in deference to that and be respectful and cool. It's still me walking in looking like I look, you know, it's just kind of, And it took a few weeks. I think once he saw that we were serious, you know, I mean, we're talking, this is 21 years ago. Once he saw that we were actually serious and I guess the most importantly, I made Pearl happy.
Yeah.
I didn't judge a book by its cover, but you know, I didn't act or I'm not maybe how people think I'm going to be when like people might, you say like, oh, is Meatloaf a lunatic? You know, people of course think I'm a crazy lunatic all the time too. And I couldn't be more the opposite of that. So, a few weeks in, then we became, you know, really good friends. I think once he saw that, oh, Scott's a good guy, you know.
Yeah.
But he didn't make it easy at first. And I, you know, I give him a lot of credit for that, actually.
That's what dad's got to do, man. Yes. You have to do that. You got to create the image that if you fuck up, I will kill you. Yeah. So, and then, I mean, just, but to also be getting that from Meatloaf. I mean, that's like,
yeah. And he is, I mean, he's definitely intimidating, you know,
sure.
He's also a great actor. So on top of all that, he can really turn that on and give you the look, and you know, like he knows how to give that look really well, and you know, so yeah. And but I didn't get it nearly as bad as some of her high school dates and / boyfriends at the time.
Pearl, what's the most intimidating shit that your dad's ever done to any guy that's ever picked you up?
The time that he met my date at the door with a baseball bat.
Nice.
Yeah. I didn't appreciate it on that day, but I love it now. I love that he did that because he was right. The boy wasn't really a good guy. But he changed my curfew that night to 9 p.m.
Nice.
I was 16. And he told me to wait inside. The boy pulled up and the boy came to the door. And my dad was sitting out on the porch with a baseball bat, tapping it in his hand. And he looked at him and he said, "You get her home 9 o'clock on the dot, not a minute later and not a minute earlier. 9 on the dot." And he said, "And if you don't, I'm going to come find you. I'm going to hunt you down and kill you like the dog you are."
Holy shit.
Holding his baseball bat. And then we went off to the party and the guy's checking his watch the whole time. Like, you know, and, we pulled up back at home. My dad was sitting out on the front porch waiting for us with the baseball bat. The boy walked me to the door and my dad didn't say a word. He looked at his watch and he just went and walked inside.
And then the guy was like, "Yeah, I'm not going to call you." He's like, "I'm scared shitless. I'm done. This is done. This is done." How did you guys meet? Like, you know, is it a great story or like, was that a show? Like, how did you guys get together?
Yeah, it's a great story.
We met on tour in 2000. We met on the Maximum Rock Tour. I was singing and dancing with Motley Crue.
Nice.
And the tour was Motley, Megadeth, and Anthrax. So we were like tour buddies.
Yeah. Well, I had a huge crush on her not right from the start.
When I introduced myself to him in catering on the first day,
right.
I went up to them because I recognized them and I was like so excited. I love Motley Crue so much and I was so excited to be there and part of the band. And my first day at work, I was walking around and introducing myself to everybody. Like, "I'm Pearl, I'm going to be singing with Motley Crue." And I walked into catering and Anthrax was in there and I said, "Oh, that's Anthrax. I'm going to go over and say hi, you know?" And I went over and I said, "Hey, I'm Pearl." Put my hand out to Scott and he just kind of went like that. And he didn't say a word. I thought he hated me.
He's being a nice Jewish boy.
That guy really has a fucking problem.
Well, the story behind that was I was working on a project. Long story short, I was working on a DVD edit for a sideband project of mine, SOD, with her ex-husband. And the thing went down over some money, and I ended up, he claimed he was short money. I ended up getting him the money. But meanwhile, I know I'm going out on tour with Pearl and I'm thinking, oh, Kevin probably said a whole bunch of crap about me. She probably hates me. She thinks I'm some kind of jerk. Yeah. Meanwhile, I found out afterwards, there was nothing at all.
And we were,
but getting- I just kind of put my head down because I was like, oh God, she probably thinks I'm this like giant asshole. And, but then we quickly discovered a couple of days in that it was not the case at all. And then we became drinking buddies on the tour and hanging out every night. And I had a huge crush But you know, there's a, you don't shit where you eat on tour.
No, of course not. Not
always a bad idea. So, yeah, we just hung out as drinking buddies, and then about 3 or 4 weeks into the tour, Anthrax left the tour, and I was super bummed because it was like another 3-4 weeks, and I wasn't going to get to hang out with Pearl, and I never got to tell her how I felt, and because I was chicken basically, and so I got home and I wrote her this like 5-page handwritten letter, and I FedExed it out to her on the tour.
Well, it was 10 pages because it was both sides.
Right? It was both. Oh my God.
Yeah. And then we would talk every night. Like I'd be out and she'd be on the bus in the middle of nowhere somewhere, you know, driving in the middle of nowhere. And 3 o'clock in the morning, I'd be walking home from a bar and we'd like talk every night. But she had never said anything about the letter. And I never brought it up because I figured, fine, we'll just be bros, you know, that's it. I'm not going to push, you know, or anything like that. And then it was September 9th. 2000, Pearl was home from the tour. She got back to LA and I said, hey, you want to go out? There's a couple of cool bands, you know, playing at the Troubadour. And do you want to go? It was
High on Fire
and Nebula and super romantic, you know, bands. You know, Matt Pike with no shirt on, his big old belly hanging over his guitar. And you want to go see High on Fire at the Troubadour? She's like, yeah, cool. And I brought my friend Kenny. And
I showed up with my sister.
Yeah.
So nice.
It's just friend zone. That's it. And then I don't know if it was actually, that night?
Yeah, we went home together.
Right.
And we never left each other's side.
That was it. Yeah. I said, did you what about my letter? And I don't want to put words in your mouth. Like,
what did I say?
You said I kept trying to write you something back and everything.
I didn't know what to say. Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, we were both out of
coming out of
bad marriages.
Yeah.
So
yeah,
it wasn't something that it kind of smacked me in the face. I didn't know what to say.
Do you still have the letters?
Yeah.
Dude, you should frame that, dude. Break that out. We literally
like pretty much just like, that's it. September 9th, 2000. We've never been apart. Well, I mean, we have.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, obviously, but
we've been together since then. Yeah.
Have you written any more letters? You staying in the letter game, bro?
Yeah, I have.
We celebrate the anniversary too. The first date anniversary. We've celebrated it for 21 years.
Yeah.
That's incredible, man. That is so badass. I love it. I love it. All right. Let's talk about the album. Let's do some tracks. Okay. And please just give me your thoughts on what you guys think of these songs, what it brings up, whatever. Like we mentioned it earlier, the track Bat Out of Hell. This track is a result of Steinman's desire to write the most extreme crash song of all time. He said, there is something so thrilling to me about that operatic narrative that involves a cataclysmic event, especially one so perfectly in tune with a teenager's world and rock and roll as a car or motorcycle crash. The song's protagonist is a boy who wants to take the girl he loves out of their dead-end town, but dies in the attempt. So like I said, this is like one of the first times I've actually heard this record, putting it on for the first time. It immediately drew me in, and immediately I was just like, okay, I understand what this is going to be. I'm ready for it. It's setting you up for the rest of the record. Thoughts on this? Cause I was blown away.
Yeah. What an opener, you know? It's almost a metal song, you know? It's so heavy. So some parts are straight up metal. Yeah, and God, that guitar solo, it's Todd Rundgren on the record, right?
Who plays
the guitar solo? I mean, the guitar solo is insane. Yeah, the whole theme, the boy wanting to get the girl out of the dead-end town, and it ends horribly. And I mean, as a, you know, me listening to that record at you know, 14 years old, it was just like, not that I lived in Queens, so maybe it wasn't so much a dead-end town, but still, I understood that. I identified with it so much. All I wanted to do was get out of my mom's tiny little apartment, you know, get in some kind of cool car with a girl and drive to California, you know?
Yeah.
It was just so identifiable, and I connected with it so deeply. And And it also, it's just such a headbanger.
It is.
I mean, yeah. Come on. And then the dynamics, you know, you're down at the bottom of a pit in the blazing sun when it breaks down, and then the way it builds back up, and then the high notes at the end.
Yeah.
Yeah. The, what's the show where they, the albums, the great albums, and they isolate Todd's guitar, the revving of the engine. Yeah. It sounds like a motorcycle revving, but it's just Todd Rundgren on a guitar.
Yep.
Incredible. Incredible. I mean, it's every time it's thrilling. Thrilling.
It really is.
How many times does he hit the note at the end? Four times.
What was it? A G?
Yeah, like a high G or something. It's just insane.
Yeah.
It's amazing. It's
incredible song. Everything you just said about Todd playing the motorcycle. Let me see this. Rundgren himself played the section on guitar, leading straight into the solo without a break. And in Meatloaf's, in your dad's autobiography, he recalled how impressed he was at Rundgren's performance on his track. In 15 minutes, he played the lead solo and then played the harmony guitars at the beginning. I guarantee the whole thing didn't take him more than 45 minutes, and the song itself is 10 minutes long. The most astounding thing I've ever seen in my life. Have you ever talked to your dad about the recording of this, or like, does he have any inside? You have any inside scoops?
I don't think, not that one. I mean, I've always heard story, little bits, but not really. I don't feel like I have an inside scoop on on that. Aside from,
it's Max Weinberg on drums.
It is Max Weinberg and Kazem Sultan on bass when he was like 19. Kazem Sultan was in Utopia with Todd Rundgren.
You know what sucks is that Todd just played Gramercy Theater, which I live like a block away from here in Manhattan, and I have like the hookup there. And if I would have done this research like before I knew he was coming, then I probably would have gone. I'm kind of disappointed in myself in that, but.
Yeah, that being
said, like you said, his guitar work, incredible. Something else we found, according to your dad, the song is constructed from a shot near the beginning of Alfred Hitchcock's Psycho, in which the viewer looks down a valley and sees the light of a city. He says, all the clients in the Bates Motel wish they would have left like a bat out of hell. It had nothing to do, believe it or not, with Springsteen, because this does get compared to Springsteen's Thunder Road. It had all to do with Alfred Hitchcock and Psycho. So being that they pulled this, in a sense, from, you know, Alfred Hitchcock and Psycho, like how much are you guys pulling from other art that you guys have seen in your work?
Oh,
all the time.
All the time. Yeah.
Yeah. Anything in particular that like from Anthrax that you just, you know, not saying you lift, but, you know, you get a little.
Yeah, I think I've written at least half a dozen songs that were based on things that Stephen King wrote.
Really?
Certainly in the early days. Yeah. I mean, our Among the Living record, the title track, the album cover based on Randall Flagg from The Stand. Another song on that album, A Skeleton in the Closet, is based on his short story, Apt Pupil. There's many more. I've written a number of songs based on stuff from his Dark Tower series. I'm so fascinated by those books of his. It's not as much, you know, in the last say 10 years as it was in the earlier days when I was in my 20s and I had nothing personally to really write about. I had nothing to draw from within that much yet, because when I was 21, 22, I didn't really have that much world experience yet. So, a lot of Stephen King, certainly.
So you're telling me maybe on the next record, you're going to have a song that's just like Tommy Knockers. The Tommy Knockers. Well, you can have that one if you want to use it.
But I think Stephen King's actually said in interviews, he doesn't even remember writing it because he was so high on
coke
at the time in his life.
It's his coke book.
and after many years later, finding out that, I'm like, oh, no wonder I couldn't get through that book, you know? There was a song, Breathing Lightning, on our last album. Again, goes into his Dark Tower universe. I'm sure there'll be something on the next record.
What about you, Pearl? Anything you're pulling from? Like what is really helping you, you know, when you're writing, it was like, is what really inspires you from the art that you've heard?
It's cathartic for me. So things that I'm trying to figure out within myself are usually what I end
you're up pulling from
about. And sometimes I don't even realize it until I get to the end of the lyric process and I go, Oh, that's what that is. It's like a pouring out of subconscious. I have one song called Broken White that I wrote about a painting that I saw by an artist named Marlene Dumas. But I don't know. I don't write about any books that I read or things like that. Not in that way.
That'd be so funny if you guys were like sitting at the kitchen table together, like you're like, Scott, I got a whole song about The Shining. You cannot put away your Shining song. This one's mine.
Yeah.
All right, let's jump into, you took the words right out of my mouth. You know, I don't even know how to put it into words how I feel about this song. But according to his autobiography, your dad asked Jim Steinman to write a song that was not 15 or 20 minutes long. And in Meatloaf's words, a pop song. The song is about the protagonist's first ever kiss with a girl and uses, like so many songs on the record, vivid imagery, small details to help place the listener in this situation. I don't think there could ever be a better title for the experience of kissing somebody that you have a longing for. By just that, you know, you took the words right out of my mouth. It's just so perfect. Thoughts on this? You know, what does it make you feel? What does it do to you guys?
This is always a huge sing-along song when it's live.
You can't
not clap and you can't not sing along. He actually reserves like a good chunk of time in the middle for everyone to do that.
Right.
That's just really great at running the crowd, but I mean, again, it's Jim Steinman. It's Jim Steinman's lyrics that are just so. He's very visual, and he hits those emotions right on the head. You know, it's like, you know, that's exactly what I was thinking. That's exactly how it felt. You know,
yeah.
But he says it in such a beautiful, poetic, and artful way. You know.
Yeah. I get choked up when I think about it. Like, also because I have such a connection to it from that time in my life, you know, from that age of, let's say, 13, 14, 15 years old. So it's something that affected me so deeply at that age. And, you know, it stays with you in a good way.
Yeah.
Trauma as a youth, as a kid, of course, gets into you and it stays with you forever. But this is the opposite of trauma. It's just sheer joy. And the way he evokes that feeling of wanting, the longing of it's amazing.
He puts into words feelings.
Yeah.
Feelings that a lot of people wouldn't know how to put into words.
Yeah.
He does that for you.
No, yeah. Completely.
It's amazing.
It is amazing.
There's not many records that, I'm trying to think of another one right offhand and I can't, but this is one of those records that for real, like when Pearl was still singing with her dad. And I remember I went over, they were doing this thing called Night at the Proms over in Europe. And he's doing like, you know, 20 nights in an arena in Germany and then 20 nights at an arena in the Netherlands and with a big orchestra playing with him and all that. And, you know, he does these songs and I'd be out there just singing along, tears running down my face, just incredible.
Well, we haven't mentioned really, we mentioned, of course, Jim Steinman and, you know, the genius of his writing, but it really also needs to be shared by the fact that my dad is an incredible vocalist.
Yeah.
His delivery.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's what I was about to say.
Know,
yeah.
Doesn't sound like anybody else.
No.
You know, and when he sings, he puts his guts and his soul and everything into every word. He becomes that song, and it absolutely translates. Like, it's just a primal scream.
What you just said, I think, is the perfect thing to talk about Heaven Can Wait, because he's going through this, you know, he's doing the falsetto, and then he's doing his baritone, and when he brings it down, and you can hear the, like, we keep using the word longing, but it's like this love. It's like you really feel like he's singing to this woman that's right in front of him and trying to tell her, like, that heaven can wait. And it's just the, you feel the emotional weight of
it. It's so real.
He's crying while he's singing, you know, maybe not literally, but literally.
Yeah. You know? Yeah. His ability to deliver and to really, to make you feel it. I mean, you don't have a choice.
No,
it's like watching a love story unfold before your eyes, but you're listening to it. And the fact that they're able to meet and Jim, they're able to make you feel so much just sonically, because the scope, the imagination of it is so big and so strong. And so it's so vivid that you don't even need the picture, because they're painting it for you.
Yeah, completely. So from that, then we're going into another rock song, All Revved Up with No Place to Go. I mean, once again, phenomenal. You got to give it up to Edgar Winter, who plays saxophone on the song. He's incredible. And this is another song describing the beginning of a relationship between a high school couple and the sexual frustration that comes along with the horniness of being a teenager. The track details the different ways the main subject would like to relieve those frustrations. I mean, I don't know if either one of you guys know, like, how, like, I mean, they're writing these songs about teenagers. How old was your dad and Jim when they're making this record? Adam, do you know? This is an Adam moment. Adam will have this in 2 seconds. Like, just the idea that they're writing these songs about teenaged angst, and it's like they're nailing it.
So it's like, I mean, late 20s, early 30s when they're really starting.
Late 20s, probably when they were writing it, because if you figure it came out in 77, so.
Yeah.
So when they were writing it, that period before that, you know, at least a, you know, year or two. So yeah, late 20s.
So Scott, what is this like, you know, like you said, 13, 14 years old, hearing these songs or hearing All Revved Up with No Place to Go about being horny and stuff. And of course, I mean, you're a dude at 14. We're all like all ka-chunk it out. So, I mean, like, what is this doing to you? What do you think about it? Thoughts? What are your experiences?
Yeah, I mean, that song, it was never so much that actual message for me. It was just more, it was such a kind of up-tempo, kick-ass rocker.
Yeah.
That I don't think I was looking too deeply initially. Like, when I was listening to it, it was probably years later when I actually realized what they were actually talking about in the lyrics. Maybe I wasn't looking for it. Obviously, we'll get to Paradise. That was a little bit more obvious.
Yeah.
What they were talking about, to me anyway. But with, yeah, All Revved Up and No Place to Go, for me, it was just like, you know, I don't know, just wanted to go out and rage. That's what, like, me and my friends, that's how we took it as, just like, go out and rage and party and bang your head and drinking beer and, you know, just having a good time. And that's what we got from it.
What
got out of it.
What it reminds me of is, like, my dad was really into Mel Brooks films and showing to me, like, you know, Young Frankenstein, History of the World when I was a kid. And it's like, I just thought it was funny then, but then it's like, the older you get, you're like, oh, you get all of these jokes. So maybe just at the time, yeah, it's like, you, on the surface, it's just a rock song. But there's, like, so much going on in this, you know, and then you get to Two Out of Three Ain't Bad, a beautiful power ballad.
I mean, the lyrics, like, I was a varsity tackle with a hell of a block. When I played my guitar, I made the canyons rock. I mean, that's just, come on, windmill guitar chords. You know, I had long hair back then, so just, you know, I mean, that's what it was for me.
And the end of the song, when it really revs up and it gets faster.
Oh yeah.
It's just like,
it's phenomenal. It's phenomenal. It's just teenage bravado, man. It's like, we don't even realize we're doing it while we're doing it. And then we can look back and be like, oh no, that's perfect. All right. 2 out of 3 ain't bad. A beautiful power ballad, sung from the perspective of someone breaking up with their significant other, trying to explain to them why the relationship is going nowhere and is at this point loveless. It also highlights the importance of love and relationships as opposed to just sexual desire. This was released in a single in the UK. It reached number 11 and was Meatloaf's second highest charting hit in the US behind I'd Do Anything for Love, But I Won't Do That. Thoughts on this? Because I've got Todd Rundgren identifies how the song was influenced by the Eagles, which I definitely hear, who were very successful at the time. Also highlights the underlying humor in the lyrics, citing the line, "There ain't no Coupe de Ville hiding at the bottom of a Cracker Jack box." Yeah, that was like, that was something that was like, I mean, as I was listening to this, I was like, oh, did he have like a deal with Cracker Jacks? Like, that would have been really good, like, product placement. Thoughts on this? Because I think it's incredible.
Yeah, amazing.
It's a beautiful song. I can't tell you how many people have told me or my mom or my dad, 2 out of 3 ain't bad. I love your song, 2 out of 3 ain't bad. That was our wedding song.
And it's so, yeah, people don't get it.
Like, really?
Did you listen to the words?
Okay. How's it going for you? What do you say about, I mean, it's another great, great, great song.
It's just an amazingly funny, dark, epic ballad.
And that's another thing about Jim Steinman's writing, is that it there's a humor in it, you know, there's a little bit of tongue in cheek in there, and this twist of a phrase.
The title itself, I want you, I need you, but there ain't no way I'm ever gonna love you, you know, don't be sad, 2 out of 3 ain't
bad. 2 out of 3 ain't bad,
you know. It's, you know, on paper, if I'm reading that, let's say I don't know this record, I've never heard it, and I read that line, I'd be like, I might actually think like, that's the lyric, really? I mean, it's funny, like, how does that, but then you hear it in context, it's like, it's fucking genius.
It really is. It really, really is. And speaking of genius, Paradise by the Dashboard Light. What I love about this is that it's like divided into these three different sections. From what we have is, part one is Paradise, part two is Baseball Broadcast, and part three, Praying for the End of Time. I mean, it reminds me of like A Day in the Life by the Beatles, you know, where it's like you've got three separate songs that all are equally, they all equally rule. Yeah. I mean, this was one that I kept seeing pop up. I do this show called The Goddamn Comedy Jam, where comics do stand up, then they tell a story about a song, and then they sing that song with a live band. And we've done it, you know, it was a Comedy Central show, and we've done, played all over the world with the show. And I remember this guy, Dan St. Germain, wanted to do this as one of the songs. And I feel bad, because as I didn't know this one, I was like, isn't there another Meatloaf song? So he ended up doing I'll Do Anything for Love, which was great, and it crushed. But now looking back on this song after listening to it, I was like, dude, this would have ruled if we would have done it, man. This would have ruled. This is the third single released off the record. The last single released in the States and charted as high as number 39 on the US Billboard 100, which is interesting because this is a long song. Right? This is, you know,
like close to 9 minutes, right?
Yeah. Thoughts on this? What do you guys, you know, love? Like, what do you guys think about the baseball play-by-play suddenly in the middle of the song?
Excellent.
Me as a
Rizzuto.
Yeah, I'm a lifelong Yankee fan. So the first time I ever heard it, and then it gets to the middle section with Phil Rizzuto, I was just like, oh my God. Like, again, I didn't understand how things work. How do you make songs? How do you record songs? You know, it was just insane to me that the guy I would listen to calling the Yankee games on the radio almost every night is now on this rock song I'm hearing on the radio. How? And then, of course, when I realized what they're talking about, first base, second base, all that, I was like, how did they get Phil Rizzuto to do that? That's incredible, like unbelievable. And yeah, I mean, I just think this is one of the most iconic rock songs of all time. It's instantly recognizable from the first guitar lick. Some of the best lyrics ever written. It's like you never get tired of hearing it. It's just, I wish someone would make a TV show or a movie out of it, but it would never be as good as the song. That's the
point. I mean, but,
it's just so, it's so cinematic. It's just, it's just incredible. It's incredible. And the fact that it works, that they meet and Jim were able to take this monster of a thing.
Yeah.
And it works again on paper. How's that going to work? You're going to go from this thing and then into Phil Rizzuto and then what? And then they hate each other at the end. It's not even a happy end. What? How does that work? And it's one of the best songs ever written.
Well, just thank God they didn't get Harry Carey from the Cubs. You know, that would have been a lot worse. He's like, "Wow, it's cold and lonely in the deep dark night."
Did you say it was number 39?
It charted this is the last single release in the States and charted as high as number 39 on the US Billboard Hot 100.
It's so weird to me that it was only 39 because I can't my whole life I can't think of like one prom that I went to or one wedding that I've ever been to or a bar or any place where there is a big congregation of humans and music playing that this song doesn't come on and people just, you know, bust into this duet. You know, it's like almost like Hotel California in that way where it's just everywhere, all over the world, everybody knows it, you know.
Yeah.
Well, 39 seems, you know,
in Belgium and the Netherlands, it peaked at number 1. So I mean, once again, Europe gets her. There's something about America where we appreciate stuff, but like, you know, you go, like I always say, like I spent a whole summer working for Radio One in the UK. And it was like, you went into like a record store there and they're promoting like the Rack and Tours and like rock bands. And then you come back to the States and it's like just Gnarls Barkley crazy at the time. Right. You know, it's like there's much more, I think, of an appreciation for the actual song and the structure of music when you get over to Europe. I don't know why.
The thing is that one of the main differences too with Europe is take Meatloaf, case in point, his career blows up on the first album. And, but then in the States, you know, it kind of wanes between the end of the Bat Out of Hell cycle until Bat 2, you know, almost what, 15 years later. But meanwhile, there's how many records between Bat 1 and Bat 2 that were massive in Europe? You know, all these records that were massive in Europe. And he was a full-blown, genuine arena act all of those years, you know, in between. Whereas in the States, it's like he couldn't get arrested until Bat 2 came. And then he had the big hit again. But that's why even still, like, if he goes to Europe, the UK. UK and London, he could sell out multiple nights at the O2 Arena. If he goes to Australia, he could play stadiums. You know, it's just once he got into people's psyches there, you know, on that first record, it never goes away. He's just, that's it. You reach legend status and
you're always a legend.
You stay at that level.
It speaks to the fans. They're very loyal. Yeah. Very loyal fan culture.
Also, because I think it's because they're not, you know, most artists aren't going over there a lot. They might get once a year, once every couple years. So when they come, it's like, we have to go. It's like, we might never come back to Belgium, you know? So people they're diehard. I mean, don't you experience that with Anthrax when you go, like, you know,
like, we've been going to Europe constantly since 1980. Six. So
they never
have to worry. We're not coming back.
where's the, what country would you say is just like, I'm not going to say shocked that you have the most diehard fans, but what country would you say other than the States Anthrax is like on that legend status?
South America is the best for metal.
Always, always South America. South America rules, man.
I would say the two best places are Chile and Argentina. It's always kind of neck and neck. Generally for us, Chile, for some reason, we have a connection there. They're all great. I mean, it's not like that doesn't mean Brazil is not great. Brazil is amazing too. And
yeah.
Peru is amazing. And Uruguay is amazing. And you get into Central America, Mexico, all from Mexico down to the bottom. It's all insane. There's just something about Chile that is just, I don't know what makes it so a little bit extra special. We also have a great connection in Glasgow, in Scotland. The fans there, we've always, just since the early days, since the first time we ever played Scotland in 86, Scottish fans has just really took to us. I mean, we did a live record a couple of years ago. We recorded it and filmed it in Glasgow. We called it Kings in Scotland. And I would say those two places for me, if I had a pick.
Nice. Nice. All right. Final track on the record, For Crying Out Loud. I think this is a perfect way to end the record. It Breaks My Heart. I love this song. It references many other previous songs on the album. Your dad proclaimed his love for somebody who was there for him despite everything. It was originally written for the 1975 New York Shakespeare Festival musical Kid Champion, and a recording by an unknown artist in the New York Public Library archives. Jim Steinman considers the line, "And can't you see my faded Levi's bursting apart," his most daring lyric on the entire record. Your dad also went 25 years without performing this song live, but decided in 2004 to do it. He said he felt nervous about doing it, then thought, what the hell? I can't believe he won't play this. This is like, do you ever talk to him about that? Do you ever ask like that? Why aren't you playing For Crying Out Loud?
I kind of feel like I remember that. I think I was still with him when,
I think so,
that night when he performed it.
Yeah.
And people went nuts. Like, people were crying, you know, people were like, they say, you know, nobody had heard him do it live in so long. And I don't know. I always think this song is maybe the most perfect love song. It's so heart-wrenching.
Yeah.
It really is. And it's true, that line, "Can't you see my faded Levi's bursting apart?" And it's funny, but it's also like real. You know, you're tearing me apart, like James Dean.
Yeah.
You know, it's you know, all the lyrics for giving me a child when my body was old. You know, it's just every single line is like a call right to the heart. It's just relentlessly heartbreaking and gorgeous song. Beautiful.
I don't think you could end the album any other way. I to be honest with you, I don't know if this record sells 50 million copies if it doesn't have this song as the final song, because it's like, it's just the bow that's on it. It's like, we've been through so many different styles of music. He sang from so many different perspectives, and then to end it with this, I mean, this is as good a love song as anyone that I've so far heard on this list. I mean, it's like I said, it's perfect. I mean, dude, if I saw your dad perform this live, the second I heard the first note, I'd start crying. But I cry a lot, though. So,
you, me too.
All right, a couple random facts. All right, so we asked that question at the beginning. Did this make the cut? It did not make the cut of the 2020 list. But this 2020 list is not good. I'm telling you guys right now, it is a not good list. It is not good. But I think this album 100% deserves to be on there. He also released two sequels to this, Bat Out of Hell 2 and Bat Out of Hell 3. We talked about the comparisons to Springsteen. Meatloaf was an understudy to John Belushi in the touring National Lampoon show Lemmings. Did you guys, I mean, obviously, how funny is your dad? Like,
Dad's pretty funny.
Mm-hmm.
And actually, John was one of Dad's closest and best friends. He used to come when I was a little girl. He used to come over a lot. Yeah, they loved each other. They were best buddies.
Yeah.
She plays it down. She used to hang out and like watch movies with John Belushi.
Really?
Yeah.
He came over one time and I was little, so I remember him being really tall, and he came in the front door and he was like, "Hey, Pearl," like that. And he did that thing, you know, like Spanky from The Little Rascals. He would push up his bicep and go, "Look at my muscles. I just have this vivid memory of him doing that. And then I asked him if he wanted to watch a movie with me, and he said yes. And I got out my favorite movie at the time, VHS tapes. It was on two VHS tapes. And he sat and watched both tapes of the Blues Brothers with me and didn't tell me it was him. He was like, this is a great movie, Pearl. Good choice. And I was like, yeah, isn't it great? It's really funny. Yeah, he was just a great guy.
That's great. That's it. And then he was like, "You guys want to? How about we watch another movie? Maybe Animal House. I don't know if you're into it." Dude, that's great. All right, so I ask these questions. One of them, I don't know if I can ask Adam because it's all right. So first question is favorite track on the record. What are both yours?
Oh, so hard.
Gotta pick one.
I did say before, have to pick one.
Yeah.
Well, then I think I already said it. I have Bat Out of Hell, I guess, the title track. But
what do you got, Scott?
I want to say Bat Out of Hell, but Two Out of Three Ain't Bad.
Two Out of Three Ain't Bad.
God.
Heaven Can Wait. Took the words.
I'm going.
That's tough.
I'm gonna go Two Out of Three Ain't Bad.
Okay. Now I ask these next two. I can't ask the third one, but the second one is what is your least favorite track on the record? Like, so, but being that this is a perfect record, which one would you be like, all right, I might just skip to get to this next one. Is there anything off here you would skip?
Let me see the order again. I mean, I wouldn't skip anything.
But maybe for time you'd skip like a long one.
I guess
like,
so just looking at the sequence, and probably as a kid, I probably did this. I probably skipped Heaven Can Wait to get to All Revved Up.
Okay. Pearl, you already answered it. I can't ask the next one, but I'm going to tell you what the question is because it's just the third question is what song on this record would you fuck to? That's what I ask, but.
This is also the first time we've had a couple on the show.
Yeah, we've had a couple. And then also one of them being, you know.
Yeah.
The daughter.
That's never happened.
Okay.
Yeah. I don't generally choose to listen to my.
I wouldn't. No, I don't think that you would. But I have to do it. I think we got the laugh anyway. That's all that matters. And then the last question, and I do have one follow one I want to ask you, Scott. But actually, I'm going to ask that now before I get to it. Did you have any idea that you were changing music when you did Bring the Noise?
Well, no, we didn't know what would happen after, you know, we just, for us, it was just, there was a very big kind of mutual admiration society between us and Chuck D and Public Enemy. And, we just knew we wanted to do something together. And, you know, he had already name checked Anthrax in that song. And then I had the idea on our end to do an arrangement Anthrax style and then have Chuck and Flav be on it. But again, we were just doing it for ourselves.
Yeah.
I mean, we knew we were going to put it out, but it was just ourselves. I wanted to hear Chuck's voice on a track with my guitar. I thought the idea of my guitar tone and Chuck's voice together was the heaviest thing I could imagine. And I just wanted that to happen. And that was like the extent of it. And then I did it. Whatever happened after that, you know, that's completely out of our control or what's going to happen. But the fact that many people were influenced by it, certainly that, because I mean, I've had people tell me in bands like Rage Against the Machine or Linkin Park that specifically some of the Linkin Park dudes were at the Anthrax Public Enemy show at Irvine Meadows in California in 91. and like walked out of that show saying, what we did together at the end of the night where we would do Bring the Noise together, they were like, that's what we want to do. That's the kind of band we want to make.
Yeah.
And that just does that, put the two together, you know? And, but you know, when we did it, no, we had no clue.
I mean, but it's like, you're bringing together, like, you know, like it's, cause I know that there had been rap and rock in a sense and like small, like people like say, well, Blondie or whatever it is. But it's like, you honestly, you know, Anthrax at the time, one of the biggest thrash metal bands, you know, Public Enemy, one of the biggest hip hop artists. And I mean, for me, it was like, I was just in shock that you could fucking kill it as a rapper, dude. I mean, you killed it.
I still, it's hard for me to listen to myself on that, even though I've had Chuck tell me numerous times how great of a job I did and how hard it is. And I'm like, it wasn't something that I find actually physically difficult to do. I think I do a really good job with the phrasing and all that. It's just the sound of my voice. And it's my voice, because you know how it is. Most people hate the sound of their own voice.
Nobody likes to hear their own voice.
So, and then on top of that, it's next to Chuck D's voice. The fucking heaviest, the best rapper of all time.
Yeah.
In my opinion, the heaviest, the best sounding voice ever recorded. And then there's my Jewish voice from Queens next to it.
Yeah, that's so great. That's so great. I can't thank you guys enough for coming on. Last question. Do you think this deserves to be on the 500 greatest albums list and why?
Absolutely.
Yeah, of course. Yes.
Of course.
I think, you know, you said it. It's a perfect album. There's every song is fantastic. Every song is,
There's never been another album like it.
Yeah.
Before, no. And there never will be another one like
and,
it.
And
you know,
it's hugely influential on people. An artist, Axl Rose, you know, there's so many out there who, you know, have credited that, you know, this as being such a huge influence.
Axl told my dad that he would listen. He listened to Bad Outta Hell before he would go on stage.
Yeah.
On his treadmill.
I feel like you can hear a lot of this record in Use Your Illusions. Mm-hmm. You know, maybe not so much Appetite, but really after hearing you say that, it's like Estranged, November Rain, Don't Cry.
Drama, the key, the piano.
Yes.
Yeah.
Oh, 100%. I couldn't agree with you guys more. I hated to have to say that the 220 list, like I said, these lists don't mean shit. The 220 list, they focus more on a lot of the younger music. Like I think there's like 5 Drake albums on there.
Well, come on. I mean, that's 1 through 5 right there, right?
And then, yeah,
and then maybe you got to throw in a Kanye record, right? To
his
fan, you know.
But there's,
sell magazines, I guess.
Well, that's the thing is that Rolling Stone for that 220 list is playing to an audience that they don't have.
Right.
And, you know, it came out really in a time, you know, it came out in June. Well, no, not June, September of 2020, right after a summer of like, you know, of just it's, you know, racial uprising and just the world changing. And it was like, I understand why they did it, why they changed the list the way that they did. Uh-huh. And the 2012 list and the ones previous were written a lot of it by old white guys. And so it was kind of you're trying to find that balance. But like Sgt. Pepper went from number 1 to number like 26. And you're like,
on the more recent one. Wow.
Yeah. And you're like, listen, I get what you're doing, but this went from being one of the best records, or you're considered the best record of all time. And now it's all the way deeper in there. I get that. But I 100% think this record deserves to be on the 500 greatest albums list. I'm not saying this because I'm talking to the two of you. You can check my tweets I guess it was like a month or so ago when I first started listening to this. I wrote, this might be my favorite album that I've done so far on this list, on this podcast in 3 years, because I wasn't expecting it. I wasn't expecting to tear up during it. I wasn't expecting to be moved so much. I had no, like I said, I knew your dad from Fight Club. I knew your dad from Rocky Horror. I knew he was respected, and I knew this album was important, but I didn't get it. I get it. I love it. This is a record I will listen to for the rest of my life. And I can't thank him enough for, and Jim for making, and Todd, Got to give it up to Todd for putting their heart and soul into this. And you don't, you know, regardless of the accolades and the you know, the Hall of Fames or the list or whatever, your dad has something that for the rest of his life, I mean, can be so proud of, that it's like, it's one of the most beautiful albums I've ever heard. Mm-hmm. And yeah, I can't thank you guys enough for coming on, man. This was really cool.
Right. Thanks for
really
having
cool. Yeah.